Good afternoon, everybody. Today's scripture reading is from Book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 11, verse 1 to 8. And I read from ESV, verse 1. Cast your bread upon the waters, for you will find it after many days. Give a portion to seven or even to eight, for you know not what disaster may happen on earth. If the clouds are full of rain, they empty themselves on earth. And if a tree falls to the south or to the north, in a place where the tree falls, there it will lie. He who observes the wind will not sow, and he who regards the crop will not reap. Verse 5. As you do not know the way the spirit comes to the bones in the womb of a woman with child, so you do not know the work of God who makes everything. In the morning, sow your seed, and at evening, withhold not your hand, for you do not know which will prosper, this or that, or whether both alike will be good. Light is sweet, and it is pleasant for the eyes to see the sun. So, if a person live many years, let him rejoice in them all. But let him remember that the day of darkness will be many. All that comes is vanity. And today, messengers is Pastor Dave, and the title of today's message is You Do Not Know.
Thank you, Kevin. Before Pastor Dave comes out and speak, today the children will be attending the CD classes. Before they go, I'd like to pray for the children. And it's my usual practice that I'd like the children to stand up where they are. And I'll pray for you. Will you stand where you are, children? Okay. All right, let's pray. Our God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, even as during this time the children are able to come back and to attend the CD classes. We thank you for your goodness. We pray, Lord, that you continue to watch over these little ones with health, with safety, and also encourage them, Lord, that as they attend their classes, they can know more about Jesus, and help the teachers also, Lord, continue to be diligent and faithful as they teach the children. So in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Children, please proceed to your classes.
Well, good afternoon. Afternoon. Great to see all of you here in person. Great to see the kids too. It'll be really helpful as we continue in our sermon series in the book of Ecclesiastes, if you could keep your Bibles opened or switched on. We're looking at most of chapter 11, as we have just heard read to us. Well, before I begin, let's turn to the Lord in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we pray that through your word and by your Holy Spirit, you show us Jesus. Amen. The world is broken. This is the conclusion that my wife and I came to after many weeks of meditating on the words of Ecclesiastes. The world is broken, and it cannot be fixed. Wouldn't you agree? Read newspaper also can see. You know, in Singapore, we teach our children that there is some formula to success, right? We're firm believers in meritocracy, that if you work hard enough, study enough, do well enough, you will have a good life. And now we're moving towards this diversified meritocracy. There are many different paths to success, many different paths to that good life. But is this really true? Because in the last few weeks, we have heard the conclusions of Solomon's grand experiment. There is no success story. Doesn't mean that if you're fast, you'll win the race. Doesn't mean that if you're strong, you'll conquer. It doesn't mean that if you're wise, you'll be employed. It doesn't mean that if you're clever, you'll be rich. It doesn't mean that if you're knowledgeable, people will appreciate you. You can do all the right things, have the best of every skill set. And yet, sickness, accident, war, financial crisis, natural disaster, injustice, wicked men, foolish kings, death. Anything and everything will undercut you. There is no scheme that works. There is no such thing as a success story. The world is broken, my friends. The world is broken. And it's the sovereign God who made it so. This is the reality of life under the sun. It is the harsh life, the cruel life, the toilsome life. We can build and build and build, but in the end, God will knock it down. It's like the Tower of Babel, right? We, the children of men, keep trying to make something of ourselves, but God's almighty hand keeps knocking it down. Boom, boom, boom. It's also frustrating. So tragic, just meaningless. In fact, the only thing we can be certain of is disruption, disaster, and death. The only thing we can be certain of in this life seems to be disruption, disaster, and death. So how to live like that? How to live knowing that everything you do, even as a Christian, will one day come to this crashing end? You think as Christian you sped from the 3Ds? No lah, you also suffer, right? You also gonna COVID, right? You also get retrenched, right? You also die, right? As Christians, we're not spared. But how to live like that? This is the question Solomon wants to address in his penultimate chapter of this book. How do we live as God's people knowing that disaster is certain? Well, this is what he says. Cast your bread upon the waters, and you will find it after many days. Now, I don't know about you, but I went to Bishan Park. And when the rangers were not looking, I cast my bread into the waters, where it promptly sank and got viciously eaten by the fishes. So what on earth is Solomon talking about? Throw your bread, your hard-earned money, into the water. And somehow, many days later, you'll get it back. It'll come back to you. Second verse continues, give a portion to 7 or even to 8, for you do not know what disaster is coming upon the earth. Disaster is coming, he says. You don't know when, you don't know what, but it's coming. Therefore, give generously to 7 or even 8. Basically, that means give as much as you can. Throw your bread into the waters. Give away all your possessions. Why? Because disaster is coming. You know, normally, if we know disaster is coming, what do we do? What would you do if you knew there's a rainy day around the corner? You buy insurance, right? Singaporeans have so much insurance. Everything also insured. Even the insurance policy also insured. Diversify your portfolio, hedge our bets, increase our savings, right? We store for that rainy day. Because we think that if I store enough, I can avoid or at least ride out the incoming storm. But Solomon says if the clouds are full of rain, they're going to empty themselves on the earth. And if a tree falls to the south or the north, in the place where the tree falls, there's going to lie. The storm cannot avoid one. You see, a dark cloud means will rain one, right? And if a tree falls, can you stop it? Can you even change the direction which it falls, where it lies? No, right? You cannot alter the wind or the rain. You cannot stop the storm. You can't even mitigate the risks. I mean, think about it. You buy insurance and sure, you get through one round of cancer, but then there's another. And then you die. No such thing as death insurance. Your company survived the pandemic? Well done. But now there's war, petrol prices, market crisis, supply chain issues, one thing after another thing after another thing. How resilient you want to be? You pivot until dizzy or not? One day the reserves, whatever sky-high number they are, one day the reserves, they're going to run dry. There is no point to hoard or to store resource, Solomon says, because disruption, disaster, and death will happen again and again and again, and all will be stolen from you. You cannot out-insure the wind and the rain. He who observes the wind will not sow, and he who regards the clouds will not reap. If you're waiting for some right time, you're going to wait forever. You will do nothing. There will never be a right time, the ideal situation. The minute you think your life is going well, oh look, it's a sunny day, I can finally go outside. Then you step outside the front door, boom, the thundercloud bursts on your head. Life like that one, right? Really? There's no such thing as a good day. Murphy's Law holds true. Friends, you cannot control life. You cannot game this life. The more you try to hold, the more you're going to find it slipping through your fingers. Singaporeans, I love control. I think we're so clever. Can handle anything. Our great learning equips us for everything. And yet when COVID hit, just all went out the window. Anxiety and OCD went through the roof. Even till this year, 80% increase in Singaporeans needing anxiety counseling. What does that tell you? We have control issues. We boy tahan not being able to handle the next thing, not being able to prepare for the next thing. We don't even know what the next thing is. And that thought can be paralyzing, can't it? That thought, I don't know. I don't know what's going to happen. It cripples us. How to live when disruption is around the corner? And we don't know when, or what, or how bad. How to live like that? How to live like that? As you do not know the way the spirit comes to the bones in the womb of a woman with child, so you do not know the work of God who makes everything. You know, Scripture often highlights that there are two moments in life, two moments when we are utterly vulnerable, where everything, literally everything, is taken out of our hands. The womb and the tomb. The womb and the tomb. The times that we have no control, no say, not even conscious of what is happening. God is the one doing everything. So Solomon says, just like that time when you had no idea what God was doing to you in the womb, now, despite the fact that you're fully grown, mature, intelligent, educated adults, but still, you do not know. You do not know what is happening. You do not know the work of God. And that can be really infuriating, can't it? Especially when disruption and disaster hit and your life goes into a tailspin. God, I want to know what's going on. I want to know what's happening. Explain yourself, oh God. Why is this happening to me? But God gives no answer. And so we get angry. So frustrated with God. It's like my kids. You know, when they're unhappy with daddy. They're upset with the tasks I gave them or the conditions I set for them, and they get frustrated. Sometimes I cheekily go up to them and say, "Hey, you angry, is it? You want to fight, is it? You want to fight with me, is it? Come, let's fight." So how? You angry with God, is it? You want to fight with God, is it? Can. There are many people in the Bible who tried to fight with God. Job. Jonah. Jacob. What answer did they get? What answer did they get? "Who are you, O man, to talk back to God?" No answer. You know, upon reflection, I wonder, each time we are vexed with life, infuriated with our circumstances, each time we cry, "What is this? Why is this?" Perhaps those are the moments that tell us we are yet unable to accept the sovereign will of our Father in heaven. Each time we hit a frustration point in life, it is an indicator we are unable to accept the sovereign will of God. But let me ask you, what was God doing in the womb? He's creating you, wasn't he? In the deep darkness, he was forming your inward parts. He was knitting you together. His eyes saw your unformed substance. He intricately weaved you in the depths. He wrote your name and all the days of your life in his book when none were yet written. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. That's what God was doing in the dark. When you do not know, he was making something good. He's making you. So what is God doing in disaster today? When he sends the storm, when he smacks down the building blocks of your life? What is God doing? I don't know. No one knows. But surely, it is something good. But can you accept this? Can we accept this? That phrase, "you do not know," can indeed be crippling when we desire control or stability or predictability. Or it can be liberating when we trust our fate, when we trust all our todays and tomorrows and all the many troubles they will bring into the hands of a sovereign God. I don't know what's happening, but he does. He does. Tell you what, why don't we try a little exercise? Let's do a little exercise together, okay? Breathe in. Hold a few seconds and breathe out slowly and say, "I don't know." Do it 3 times, okay? I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. But God knows. And it's okay. It's okay. Isn't that a better way to live? Notice how Solomon's attitude begins to change in the following verses. "In the morning, sow your seed, and at the evening, withhold not your hand, for you do not know which will prosper, this or that, or whether both alike will be good." That's quite optimistic, right? Yes, disaster is coming, but go for it. Work hard, plant the seed, keep working till evening. Something will prosper. You don't know what, you don't know how, but something will prosper. Maybe everything will be good. Light is sweet, and it is pleasant for the eyes to see the sun. And what happened to the harsh sun? And suddenly, instead of an oppressive force, it's become sweet and warm, comforting and good. Have circumstances changed? No. World's still broken. But the preacher's attitude to circumstances has changed. That's what happens when we learn to accept the sovereignty of God. When we let God be God. I don't know, but it's okay. In fact, it's more than okay. It is good because He is good. In fact, I don't know if you noticed, but throughout the book, the preacher's attitude seems to shift. In the beginning, he was extremely frustrated, extremely negative about the meaninglessness of life. But as he continued this, his great experiment, amidst all the sorrows and disappointments along the way, his eyes were forced to turn to God. God is the one who gives all joy. God, the giver of food and drink. God who assigns us our portion, our lot in life. God who gives us the days of our life. God who approves of the deeds of the righteous. And today, the God who makes everything. As Solomon slowly accepts the reality of an almighty God, the joy factor increases. Disaster is still around the corner. Disruption and death are still the operating system of creation. But now there is joy. So if a person lives many years, let him rejoice in them all. But let him also remember that the days of darkness will be many, and all that comes is vanity. As we move towards the end of the book, I think we begin to see Solomon's motive. It is joy. He's been on this journey, a quest to find joy. Yes, the world is broken, but God broke the world in order that we might find joy. God broke the world in order that we may find joy in God. So if a person lives many years, rejoice in them all. Well, let's go back to the verses that we started with. What does this mean? Cast your bread upon the waters, and you'll find it after many days. Give a portion to seven, even to eight, for you do not know what disaster is coming upon the earth. Disaster is coming, but God is working. Therefore, whatever you have, whether skill or money or talent, give them generously, invest them heavily, use them aggressively. Those of us who know the reality of sin and the reality of God should be the biggest risk takers in the world. The people who know it's foolish to hoard or store, the people who know we cannot outrun the storm. The people who are convinced that if we invest in the work of the master rather than bury our talents in the sand, that whatever we do, we trust whatever we do, it will be rewarded. It will reap return somehow, somewhere. I don't know, but it will reap return. Throwing bread into the water is not as reckless as it sounds. It's a way of wisdom. In a broken world, it is the way of faith. As the Apostle Paul once said, make the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. Make the most of every opportunity because the days are full of disaster. So, how to live life? Maybe it's time to do something crazy. Foster children, work with refugees, stand for election, quit a great job to come into full-time ministry, start a church plant, become a missionary, all of the above. Why not? Is it really so crazy? What do you think? Let's take a moment to pause and pray. Let's be silent for a minute to let the words of God sink into our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.